the fun starts. This is where we move away from the global, the regional, and to some extent local data that was really sort of thrown at you this morning. I think a lot of very extremely important and interesting statistics and data points coming from this side of the floor. But I think it's time to hear from you as to where you believe the real challenges on the ground in East Africa are. And just imagine, we're giving you the opportunity to write your top three priorities, the top three things that keep you awake at night from the perspective of trade in the digital economy. And this is your opportunity to write to your policymakers what you want to see changing. So we're going to give you 10 minutes, and we'd like you to talk around your tables, or if there are perhaps too few people on your table, so sit with the next one as well. And at the end of 10 minutes, we'd like you to have come up with your top three priorities. And as I say, this will be going back to the policymakers to say, you know, for trade and for the digital economy really to take off in the East African community, this is what we need. Any questions? Is that straightforward? Okay. Is everyone comfortable in how they're going to be grouped together? Yeah? Okay, your time starts now. And then just to say, I'd like one speaker from each group to sort of present back to the rest of the team at the end of the 10 minutes.
Well, yes. Yesterday we were grouped by sector, but now it's just, let's just have three groupings that we come up with three set of priorities of where we think the challenges are in terms of moving digital trade forward.
And we'll be walking around the room, so if you've got any questions or if we think that you're going off track, we'll help bring you back on track. Huh? Thanks. Okay. Great. Who's going to go first? I think this team here looks rather ready. Who's your speaker, please? If you can come up, the team leader, if you can come up to the podium, and then we'll be taking notes.
Good afternoon, everyone. My name is Haika Lawere, and I'm from Tanzania. I'm representing our Water Association of Women in Tourism. So my group is called Tanzania Group, maybe. I was told to name or baptize my group. So it's Tanzania. So among the challenges which disturb us, which make us lack of sleep, one of it can be familiar, but that's the common one, is cybercrime. There's no data protection. Intellectual property is an issue, as we said. Also, there's high cost of internet. Even in Tanzania or other places, you pay the internet, but maybe you get the value you pay, maybe let's say $20, the gigabyte you get is less compared to maybe Europe, America, and other country. So you find most of the people, you pay very little to get that which is the minimum. So for us, if there's a way it can be sorted out or solved by more infrastructure investments to make sure the internet goes down, we'll truly appreciate. Also, there's a problem of a poor quality of the services. Yes, we've already paid for the internet, maybe $50 per bundle, you get 20 gigabytes, but even the quality of the services, you don't have it, you call your maybe Airtel or Tigo in Tanzania, they don't respond that you don't have internet, maybe it is low. You can have it, but the signal are very low. And the staff and the companies which deal with the internet, they are still very low in responding to our problems. So the poor quality of service of the internet is itself, even if you are capable of paying, it's a problem. Okay, so but generally we said also there's a problem of most of the target group in our society which are supposed to use the internet, maybe the entrepreneurs, women, youth, and other, the rest of the population in the village, are not aware of the importance of internet. So we need education, awareness. We have radio, TV, flyers, just mass communication to reach out to these people who are doing businesses, and the internet is critical and important to them or to us, but we are not aware. Even me today, I came here, I've gained some insights on how important the internet is. So I wish more of my people, they could know how important. You might know, but knowing the importance is something else. The other thing we discussed in our group is, there are some policies and things which are already there about the maybe cyber law and other things, but their level of implementation. Most of things are there already, maybe the cyber crime, if there's an act or law or whatever it is, but in this country, some of them, they are not there. So like we say, the law must be translated into reality. So there must be if bodies or a way whereby these laws come into reality, into the real. For example, say there's a data protection. So even now, even today, you can buy something and still they take your money, they don't deliver the service, or they deliver or poorly delivered. So those policies, protection things, how do they help that person who still up to date is still suffering? I heard about WTO and all those things. I'm told they're supposed to do that. Even those who, for example, they are doing internet, they order something and it does not come. So are there already laws or things which can help us protect from that? Also, we are told internet should be, or maybe it's already maybe in other places, and internet should be a human right. In Rwanda, I'm told it's a human right. I'm not sure, but I'm told that. So if we can make that a slogan maybe in all of this region to be a human right. But for example, Hong Kong and other cities in the world, they do free internet. It's good because it promotes the economies and the business and everything. So what about in East Africa? Can it also be done in that way? Or can somehow, if there are aid coming, can also some places or chunks of places be having that?
Okay,
so
great.
That we have that advantage as well of internet to be a right of a person. Even the new built buildings, the permit, there should be one of the list, internet portals and the internet availability should be there. Those are our suggestions. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Thanks. Who's next? Or do I have to choose? Okay, how about the table? Okay, you'll be next. I thought you needed more time. You'll be next.
Good afternoon. From our group, our discussion really centered around a number of things. The first among which we agreed on was the need for data. What kind of data are we talking about? We know that there are organizations within our different countries that are given the mandate of collecting data on a lot of things. We have the bureaus of statistics, but we're talking about the need for a harmonized kind of environment where this data that is collected is made available to a wide array of stakeholders to enable proper mapping of what exactly are the requirements within the sector so that we can then develop proper approaches to ensure that these are sorted. Then another aspect was someone mentioned the need for marketing. A number of cases, for example, of where we have organizations carrying out different activities within our countries, but there's lack of proper knowledge of these outside the country or even within the country. My colleague who just left talked about the fact that some of these things are new to a couple of us because there hasn't been a concerted effort to market these to our citizenry, but also to our partners abroad. And my group felt that the government, particularly in the persons of the chief executives of the country, would play a very vital role that when they go out there, these are some of the things they are pushing when they have those one-on-one talks with different partners from abroad. Then the other item was infrastructure. We packaged it as infrastructure, but it was wider than that because in this we talked about, number one, the skills in the market where you find a situation that you set up some form of industry and you may not be able to retain maybe the right skill set as far as programming is concerned or the right skill set as far as customer service is concerned to drive this industry forward. So there was a need to put in place facilities that enable these skills to develop, maybe through partnerships, maybe through concerted efforts to encourage participation in certain education directions. Then, of course, the aspect of under infrastructure, there was also the aspect of bureaucracy, where you have rules that have been set up, for example, to enable favored status to a company that is bringing in goods, to ensure that when the goods come in, because of the fact that this company has attained a certain level, you're certain that what they are bringing in is safe and good, but nonetheless, in spite of having given them this, you hold the goods at the port until 2 weeks, 3 weeks, which also affects the entire value chain as it moves on. Then now, of course, finally, the infrastructure bit was also the aspect of internet access. If we're talking about a digital economy that revolves around fast and reliable internet, then we need to do something that enables this to be in place in order for people to take advantage of it. Thank you.
Thank you. I can see some very long lists, which is great, but remember, policymakers are simple people, right? So we need to, you know, I'd really like you to sort of say number one, number two, number three, yeah? And then we're going to obviously sort of, you know, get a summary at the end in terms of the, you know, what is top three for the whole room, okay? Thanks.
Good afternoon, everyone. I'm from that group over there. We weren't creative enough to come up with a name. Our first challenge is access, content, and affordability. The aspects on access and affordability have been, you know, spoken on a little bit by that group. Let me just expound some more on the content issue. We need to have locally designed solutions for our problems, so that we're not looking at an app that, even when it comes to a sales app that has, for the address options, they're asking us about states and streets and zip codes. We want our own locally designed applications, and content developers need to be able to address this issue. Then, of course, the access and affordability, I think, is a little bit obvious. Okay, the second challenge is harmonized regulation, and I feel like this is one of the things at this early stage, when you're trying to navigate this area, we need to be very careful about, let me give an example, on the issue of tariffs on small packages. It needs to be standard along across East Africa, so that me buying a good something here online should be the same as buying something while I'm in Tanzania. Or otherwise, it doesn't make sense if the tariffs are different. So if we could get this one right, I know we've not been able to get it right with other issues within the region, but as it relates to digital commerce and e-commerce, we need to be able to address this issue uniformly. And then the third issue is financial interoperability. And this actually is showcased through the lack of a currency union. If I want to buy something within the region, let's not talk about other areas. If I want to buy something in Tanzania through a website, and I have to start thinking about, oh, the cost is in Tanzanian shillings, I have to think about the headache, oh, how am I going to make my payment? Okay, I'm just going to abandon that route. So that's showcased by the lack of a currency union, and probably let's sneak in there exchange control as well. So those are our three challenges according to our group. Thank you. Yes. Yeah. You got it.
Who's next? I'm going to go with this table here.
Afternoon. The discussion in my group was mainly an argument about between those with views sympathetic to the private sector and those whose views lean more towards the policymaker. So it's with that we named our group the private regulators. And the issues that we're discussing, well, the motive of everyone in the private sector is to make a profit, is to turn a profit, and the role of the regulator is to protect consumers. So how does this factor in the digital trade environment? Well, we found that, okay, companies and the private sector will always push for profit, and they're doing that very well. But then sometimes the government can lag behind as far as becoming innovative in the regulatory process is concerned. And thus, whenever the government, especially in emerging economies, comes up with a regulation, it's usually, it might end up punishing the entrepreneur more than it does solve the problem and protect the consumer. So you have, we took the example of Bitcoin, for instance, where in Kenya it was just given a blanket ban. No consultation was provided, at least that we know of, as the public. It was just said that at this stage, the economy cannot handle both a Kenyan currency and a digital currency. Well, if we look at other economies, there was more of a consultative process. Stakeholders were considered, and it wasn't just given as a blanket ban. So the first solution that we came up with was that the government should become more innovative in its regulatory approach. Not just, you know, for instance, if maybe a working paper was tabled in parliament about Bitcoin, probably just a handful of the parliamentarians would probably be aware of what Bitcoin is. And if we expect that group to actually vote on such an issue, you know, we might end up not with a policy that isn't really well thought out. So the first solution that we came up with that is there should be multi-stakeholder dialogue and consultation. And one way we can do this, given our current form of government, is through interagency working groups. That was our first solution. Second, we have to accept that if, and now this is on the private sector side, for digital trade to succeed, it will call for higher ethics and best practice in the private sector. The issue has been raised. What if you make a payment online and the goods do not come through? You know, is there any way for the private sector to be held accountable? And you see now that's on the businessmen and business people and the merchants concerned. Digital trade will not be successful given the current level of ethics and best practice in emerging economies. Private sector needs to up their game and improve their own ethics. And I mean, the government should also, I know the government is not in this to make money, but still the regulatory making process should not be so long and time wasteful. It should be dynamic, as if the government was in business, and the private sector should improve their ethics if digital trade is to become successful. Thank you very much.
I was actually just told by my colleague right here that who's in the government regulations, regulatory system, that apparently there do exist systems that account for various, inclusion of various actors as they come into the market, whether it's, you know, including them in the drafting of the regulations, the production of those regulations, and et cetera. Anyway, so I don't turn this into a lecture. I'll just go through our three quick items that we came up with. First and foremost is the idea of keeping information up to date. You can't exactly trade if you're shipping something, and as something's being shipped, the regulation changes, and you're stuck at port dealing with all the backlog of, you know, managing those regulations. Or if you're a small scale trader, for example, and you get to the border and are faced with an official who tells you a regulation that you haven't heard of, you know, that leads to, I guess, another issue that we came up with, which is giving that information in an accessible way to every stakeholder, whether you're the, you know, the big or small guy who's, you know, stuck at the border, trying to process some commodities across. And then, of course, well, I guess we'll just give two more. One more is making sure that information is up and running at all times. So you have the e-portal, for example, and you want to make sure that people can access that information when you need it. And lastly, from the regulatory side, we are concerned with the ability of the government agencies to actually be able to respond and keep up with security concerns.
Yeah, so colleagues, we've heard from everyone, everyone's group, unless we've missed out someone. Which group are we missed out? Any contribution? Yeah, so I think that we've covered everyone. The idea now is to try and go through the priorities that we got from around the room and see whether we can try and narrow down those to basically three. And the purpose of this is that when some of you and some of us that have worked on the policy formulation side is that you want issues in a very simple manner so that you can you can reach to a decision without complexities of having to go and start reading for the next 1 week or two. So the simpler we make it, and it will be better and simpler to present to policymakers in order to move policy direction forward. So I will maybe move closer to there because I can't read from here and see what we can do. Let me get a mic. So the issue of cybercrime was the first challenge. Secondly, accessibility of internet. Then quality of services needs to create internet awareness, translate laws to reality, make internet access a human right. So I think that the first issue I can identify, which is all over the place, is that of access to internet as the first priority. Access and affordability. Yeah, the two and quality. So it's access, affordability to quality internet services. Sorry, so we'll have to do one clean chat. Sorry. Yeah, sure. That's right. Yeah. So that's number one. So we go to the next group. Now I group two. Which one is group two? The ones that were addressing the need for data. What did you mean by need for data?
One of the things we find in this region is that we often find that there's insufficient data to support policy and advocacy and regulation and those sorts of things. So if the private sector, for example, goes to present itself before public officials, there's no clear mapping of different facets of the digital economy so that we understand who are the players, who are the stakeholders. There's no data in terms of the volumes of the business, the kind of infrastructure that they need. So I said I think as a first step, it's important for us to map that sector critically, and also as you're mapping that sector, to be able to identify those, what the challenges are, and how therefore they should be addressed from a policy and regulatory perspective.
Yeah, I get the clarity, because when you're talking about data in this type of setting, you may be talking about the content, as opposed to statistics context. So you're talking about the statistics in order to inform the policymakers to make decisions or regulators to make proper regulations. So that is need for data for decision making. Then there was create awareness of activities happening locally.
Marketing.
Yes. Is there a microphone there?
Yeah, thank you. Actually, in the region, there's been a lot of effort to promote this BPO industry. I know Kenya has done quite a lot of work promoting BPO industry. Uganda tried, but I think Rwanda is also trying, and Tanzania. But I think Kenya is far ahead of the rest of us in terms of the numbers of employees that are involved in BPO and the number of businesses. But you see, the issue here, as individual countries, what Kenya did, they did, they branded Kenya. I think there's some kind of Kenya brand, which they take outside there, let's say to London or to New Delhi or wherever, and they market Kenya. And the broad cost of marketing Kenya, either for tourism or for as the best place for BPO. Maybe what we need to do is now to market together as a region, whether we say, let's escalate it to regional level, rather than going as individual countries. But the efforts have been there on the ground too. And I don't think government can come in to like give the business, to market for the business, because the business must have the marketing skills itself. Government won't be the best marketeer for you.
Now, this is a bit of a challenge, because we are trying to inform policymakers on what the challenges they should overcome in order to enhance digital trade. Don't forget, we're talking about trade still. So in terms of creating awareness, you remember we're talking about digital trade, so you probably already doing business on some platform or another. So if you are talking about awareness, I don't know what government should be doing. Or policymakers should be doing in that respect. So let's move to infrastructure development. I think that infrastructure obviously is a challenge. If we are going to get access to internet, whatever, infrastructure can't be left behind. Infrastructure development, yes. The next group. Again, we see access, content, affordability, information, applications, so forth. I think that this is covered in access and affordability that we looked at earlier. We can obviously, expand on that, but it's an issue of access. Harmonized regulations locally, regionally. Which group was that? Could you just expand on that again?
We advocate for regulation that cuts across the East African community so that we don't have different policies in Kenya, different policies on e-commerce in Tanzania and the other countries. We want a unified sort of regulation so that it also creates a very predictable environment for the region.
So basically, you're looking at your tax, you're looking at your customs unions, you're looking at your standards. If the, let's say the, what do you call it, KEB standards.
Kenya Bureau of Standards certification should apply to each and every country and vice versa.
All right.
And in the presentation yesterday, we saw
where they were talking about regulation in the telecom industry, and where we had different bars showing which country has more restriction than the others. We shouldn't be seeing that graph. We should be seeing application of the law and regulation applying to everyone in the region, so it is uniform. What applies to telecom company in Uganda should be the same with Kenya and everyone. And the banking sector, and you know, cutting across everything.
Give the EU example. Okay, so we harmonized regulations across the region. Is the note there? So, yes.
Again, some work has been done. So the question would be, what is the gap? Because it was reported that under ACTAD, we did some harmonization of the cyber laws. That's a fact. I was part of that team. And we've been reading each other's laws. We know that we are like 95% talking the same things. Well, I remember we remained with a gap on e-tax. We never resolved it during that time. But the rest of the standard things we covered. Again, under Northern Corridor, some harmonization has been done. And even at Arusha level, you know, although we are Northern Corridor, it's also Southern Corridor, but we're all part of the African community. Mm. So the harmonization is ongoing on both levels. I think what we need to identify is what is missing, the work we've done so far. What else needs to be sorted out, rather than say just a blanket statement.
Yeah, well, the point being made, to be fair to that group, is that obviously the regulations are not harmonized. Mm-hmm. I mean, so even if work has started, I mean, the regulations are still not harmonized. So
absolutely,
that is still remains a challenge. So we'll take note of that and move to the next one.
Sorry, just to unpack that further, even if there is some work that's been done, it looks really nice on paper, but on the ground it's not happening, right? Let's just be real and call a spade and not a big spoon, right? There's cultural issues, there's vested interests that will lose money if these things happen to come into play. So let's just call them out. You know, if you don't give a problem a name, you'll never be able to solve it.
Thank you.
On mobile money, one last one. Yeah. On mobile money, and my brother David knows very well, we have a regulation in the Northern Corridor for one network area that started with voice, it went to SMS, it went mobile money. You can send money from Kenya, from Rwanda, to any of the two countries, in Kenya and in Uganda. But you can't do the same from the same countries to Rwanda. It's a typical example. But on paper, it's agreed. That one was passed. Between me and you, we know. But I can't send Safaricom to Rwanda. But Rwanda can send here.
All right. Is that that addresses the next point that you're talking about? Financial mobility? Implemented. Financial mobility?
Okay, actually it was financial interoperability.
Okay.
Yes.
Interoperability. Building APIs between platforms of different carriers so that money can be able to. Safaricom should be able to send to Tigo, and Tigo should be able to send to MTN, MTN should be able to send to Safaricom or Theater.
All right.
Different systems.
And this.
Mobile money for MTN.
Cash for Tico. So, but they are not connected.
But now, the APIs have allowed them to speak together.
Okay.
So MTN sends to Tico, Tico sends to Safaricom sends to whatever. So that interoperability has not become total. And if that happens,
yes, I think so. There's a gap. All right, so that's we are now on the fourth. We are going to list this and then look at priorities in the next round.
just on one point, I think you mentioned infrastructure development, but I think the point that was being made was around skills development, if I heard it correctly. So the things like programming, customer service, and I think over lunch we were talking about things like entrepreneurship. And so, there needs to be policies to bring about the right skills to support the trade in the digital economy.
I think that the skill argument was lost in infrastructure because I think the two are two different things, infrastructure and skill development. So, yeah. Okay. So that will be fine. Innovative and accommodative regulations to be developed. Through mouse tech. I think that here the issue that was being raised was that usually regulation remains behind innovation, and that there has to be some innovative way of regulators moving with the times and moving with developments, so that the regulations that they make do not stifle development in whatever sector. I think that was what was being discussed. You have a point?
Yeah, I think it's healthy.
Yes,
for regulation to move behind technology. I think it's very healthy for us. And let me make my point clear. I think for the first time in the history of this region, central banks of these countries, for the first time, sat down and allowed mobile money to operate when they had no idea what this was about. It's the first time. They only sat and said, you know what, let's just give this ghost some, let's just let it move and we see how far it takes us. But by doing that, it's promoted more trade, more investment, more innovations, more everything. For the first time they said, let's do it blindly, and they were right. To me, regulation moving ahead of technology may be detrimental to innovation. But if innovation comes to inform the type of regulation that comes into place, that is healthy for business. That's my thinking. I don't know if someone else thinks differently.
The group that initiated that.
Thank you. I think in many cases, we look at regulation as constraining. And maybe we need to change that a little bit to start looking at regulation as the act of setting a level playing ground, a framework in which to prosper. But in many ways, and maybe that's the problem with the governments that we have, is that in many times the regulation is just to control, to restrain and so on. But regulation in real sense is supposed to set a level playing ground to allow you to play fairly and also to mitigate in terms of risk, in terms of issues where you have disagreement, for example, to set the framework when you have those problems, where do you go, what do you do, and to anticipate future challenges that may exist and try to forestall them. So what happens in that case now is for you to now do what you'd call an institutional framework, where you have an institution that's trying to track and to stay ahead of the game through research, through benchmarking and best practice, so that they are always ahead and they can be able to re-guide, as maybe I should use that word, to re-guide, to re-engineer where there's an issue, where there's a new development, to re-engineer the whole framework, the architecture, so that you can continue to thrive.
Sorry to take this long, but just to unpack this and maybe build on his idea is, and I'll give an example. David had wanted to jump on this, maybe. In Rwanda, when they started the drone technology to deliver medical services to health centers in the country,
It was a project that was that government had supported, and it started and it did very well. Now, after that, land surveyors came and said, you know what? We also want to use drones in the same technology. And so there was an issue of saying, if you want to use it in non-surveying, how is personal privacy protected? Because if this is going to go around surveying land, how about the drone taking pictures of people in their private life, in their homesteads? Now, that is bringing in a law that lays a fair ground, like he was saying, for the operationalization of the drone business in the country. How will drones be controlled to be able to do what is good for business and what is not detrimental for security and for stuff like that? But the drone had to be there before they could even sit on the table. The drones have been there, the business is being done, and now brains are thinking on how to find a fair ground. And so I was just trying to add on his point to show that regulation is not supposed to be there to control. It is supposed to be there to say, if this technology has been unleashed, what is the best it can do? And how do we make sure that this technology does not do damage to human life or to businesses like we're talking about?
All right, so you're agreeing with the suggestion, and take that and move forward. There's an issue of ethical standards. Yes.
As a best practice, in terms of technology, we try to regulate. We don't describe the technology.
So you find it many, like in Uganda, we say our telecommunications regulatory regime is technology neutral. So give you a license, come with your technology, we won't say we don't want this technology, that technology. We shall regulate you, maybe on quality of service once it comes in and those kind of things. But we do, because if you do that, then you won't, the other countries will leave you behind.
We, as in Uganda,
I'm sure it is a good best practice in the region, because we have been comparing notes with the other countries. Because if 5G was to come and 4G said, I don't allow 4G in my country, don't you think you'd be losing out? I mean, it's a simple thing to look to. It's very self-evident. So I'm saying our regime in Uganda, we emphasize that we promote technology neutrality. If we give you a license to operate, I say MTN, for example, we are not going to say we want to come and put for us 4G. Because if some MTN comes with 5G, shall we say, don't roll that out? You get me from that perspective.
I think that we can move, because basically the point here has been admitted that regulators must be well informed. They must move with the time, and they should be able to set regulations that are fair to the industry, so that they are not stifling innovation. There was this suggestion on ethics on the side of private sector. I think it was from this group, ethics. It was from that group. Okay, ethical standards. And this is a question of regulation, isn't it?
Yeah. You know, it's within the scope of, if DigiTrade is to work, if in as much as we're giving the government a mandate to be dynamic in its policy making process, it's also up to the private sector to improve the ethical standards which it has, because as in the point that he's made in Rwanda, for the company that's launching drones to supply medicine, more ethics is required for them not to survey other people's private lives. And it's within that scope that I'm saying that if DigiTrade is to work, if online merchants are to become viable options, they need to improve their best standards and their ethical practice. So it's also a mandate on the private sector, in as much as we are calling on the government to become more dynamic.
Yeah, but the point that is being made is that how do you reflect that?
OK,
Okay.
You can only reflect that through regulation, isn't it?
Yes. Maybe just to add a little. You see, when you cannot regulate everything in that law, you should have complementary laws. For example, the drone issue that he came up with, the regulation of the drones as an entity might be regulated in another law, a subsidiary law, or a law that is complementary. All you need to make sure that these laws don't conflict. But you can't regulate everything in one law. For example, taxation will be regulated in the finance bill, and so on and so forth.
Yeah. Point taken. Dynamic and simplified regulation development process. I think that this speaks to the first point. Group five, providing real-time information, especially. I think that this is what we talked about, data, in the first sheet. So that has been taken into account. It's information, statistics, to inform decision-making and stakeholders. Accessibility to information, it speaks to the first point. Quick response by government on issues, e.g. security. And I think this is to do with the same issue that we're talking about, policymakers, regulators, be moving with time and being responsive to the developments in the industry. So that is already covered. So we are done. So Artie, did you take note of the points that have been raised so far?
I've been taking copious notes, and I think I'll absolutely try and consolidate.
Yeah, we can go through quickly the first point.
Yeah.
The first point is accessibility to affordable and quality internet.
Of internet, yeah.
Yeah.
I think the second one that I'd written down, which was probably the last thing you've just mentioned around ethics. I mean, I think some of the challenges, if you start breaking them down, are what can government do to protect SMEs? You know, I think in our environments we have large companies, whether they're multinationals or local companies, that seem to be having unfair advantages. So I think if I look at it from that perspective, how do we make sure that SMEs, there are SME-friendly policies so that they really do use the internet and can use it in a way that's sort of profitable and more of a sort of level playing field than it is today. The third one, you mentioned sort of infrastructure and skill, infrastructure development or skills development. Which one do we want to keep?
Well, I think that after access was infrastructure development. Then the next one was harmonization of regulations.
Yeah. Harmonization of regulations and
implementation. Yeah.
Yeah.
No, we've missed one.
Financial operability?
Yes.
Interoperability.
Whatever the word is.
Interoperability. Yeah.
That's for the financial gurus. Yeah, that's the fourth one. And fifth was innovative regulatory processes. That was it. So those are the five we have. I know. I think that there was the issue of skills. Have you?
Yeah.
Yeah. So that's the list. Now we can start to narrow it down.
Okay, I just wanted to throw some ideas at the table before we sort of wrap up. You know, one of the things, again, that we were talking about over lunch is, you know, the education system and how are we producing graduates that are really employable in this modern digital economy. And what do universities need to do? Obviously, universities can be state-funded or privately funded, but ultimately, universities have a regulator. You know, how can we sort of really disrupt the university system in the EAC such that we're producing graduates that we want to employ in this digital economy environment? So whether that's, we talked about programming, customer service, we talked about entrepreneurship, even ethics. You know, if we don't build a crop of people that really want to do business with integrity, everything sort of you know, goes away, you know, all your profits and whatever else will just sort of disappear. So I think that's another thing we need to sort of think about. What is government doing to enable you know, this next generation of graduates to be sort of relevant in the digital economy space? And even sort of overhaul the system altogether. So, you know, today, very often a graduate, the first time they go into the workplace is when they leave. If you look at what goes on in places like Germany and Switzerland, they do dual degree programs where they work and study at the same time. So maybe we need to think about things, you know, really disruptive things like that, where we're bringing our young people into, you know, the modern workplace. And I think on the ethics side, I mean, it's really complex, right? I mean, it cuts across trade in the digital economy, it cuts across trade with your hawkers, your street vendors, your, you know, bricks and mortar retail. But it, you know, something has to give, right? And if government can, you know, write all the anti-money laundering legislation, anti-bribery, anti-corruption, and a lot of countries actually have fairly decent legislation, but if it's not being enforced, and if you know, whether it's banks or other, you know, corporates are getting away with doing things that they're not meant to, you know, we're never really going to develop, right? We're never really going to get anywhere. Let's face it. So, and you know, Nigeria is known for the 419 scam. Do we really want to be known for digital economy cybercrime or digital economy, you know, sort of, barriers? You know, people creating new ways of subverting the system. So I think we do need to think about, so what sort of environment do we want to live in? And, you know, companies can use, you know, you look at Amazon and eBay and whatever else, you can rate your suppliers. If they've let you down, make it public, you know, and then it'll be, the onus will then be on the supplier to sort of, you know, come back and say, you know, what they're going to do to improve the situation. So those are just sort of a couple of other things that I wanted to throw in there that I think are, you know, probably relevant to this part of the world. Are there any last points that anybody wants to make before we conclude? You were having a very detailed discussion. I'm sure there's a couple of more things that you want to sort of share.
Earlier on in our discussion, we talked about the free movement of people and services across borders of our region. I didn't hear it very well captured in the discussions we are having, and we're giving examples of someone in the European Union, in any of the countries of the European Union, moving freely between countries, and no one asks him or her where she is coming from and where she's going. That a French man or woman will pick up his car one morning and drive to Italy, and he doesn't meet any board along the way. The only thing that tells him he's in Italy is if he sees a church and saying St. Peter's and it's written in Italy, in Italian, and he has left Saint Pierre in French, which is written in French. That's the only thing he knows, that he's in a different country. And this is what we would wish to be seen to be done here. Because even when we stage manage ourselves to say we are East Africans, we actually aren't East Africans yet. We still look at each other as Kenyans, as Rwandans, as I get to the airport in Nairobi and they ask for my passport and they, well, there is that small thing which says East African. I feel happy that there is, I'm an East African, but then I still have to go through the same procedure like a German, although a German is saying international visa. But I'm still going through the same process, yet I'm here to sign a contract and go back. That period of time is not necessary. So I was thinking if we could look at actually practicing integration. Let's call ourselves East Africans and we become East Africans actually. Let me come from Rwanda and I marry in Maasai and let the Maasai go and marry in Uganda. We become East Africans.
No, thank you very much. I mean, I'm sure that they are under issues of regional integration. You know, the ESC is discussing issues of movement of persons and so forth. And I'm sure there are protocols to that regard. We are trying to solve digital trade impediments per se. And I'm sure that we have, as ICTSD, we have been doing work, I mean, in other areas in relating to integration of the ESC. You could follow that discourse in that respect. So thank you very much for now. Let's have a coffee break, and we resume in the next 5 minutes. A quick coffee.